Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tank Rider, Into the Reich with the Red Army, by Evgeni Bessonov, narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Foreword. Many of my comrades told me that I should write my memoirs, but it is actually a difficult thing to do. After all, I'm not a professional writer. If the truth be known, I'm very far from that. But I can tell the story of my family, my childhood, and my youth, and relate to you my experiences during the years of the Great Patriotic War. Human memory is an amazing thing, and life erodes away many experiences and events. With all the burdens and cares of daily life, I had no time to indulge myself in my memories. I was not a government official or a politician, but a simple individual, just like millions of others in our country. My memoirs will concern themselves with events that I saw take place, or with those events which had an impact on me and those around me during the war. I do not claim to have a full and objective reflection of events. Human memory isn't perfect, but I will try my best. Similarly, I will not try to be too critical in my judgment of others. Things that are described in the memoirs are my personal point of view, my personal judgment, and my perception of life. These memoirs are a look back at the life of a typical member of the Red Army, a career officer who served 35 years of his life in the military, from 1941 to 1976. I entered service when I was 18, and retired at the age of 53 as a colonel. Of course, my memoirs will focus almost exclusively on the war years. There are fewer and fewer veterans left, and those who are still alive are old. I myself turned 80 in 2003. The Great Patriotic War took a tremendous toll on the peoples of the Soviet Union, but, regardless of how hard it was, the common people stood up to the test, despite heavy losses, and despite it being very hard both at the front and behind the lines. My aim is to show the war through the eyes of a participant in those events, not through the eyes of a marshal or a writer, but of a platoon leader and company commander of tank riders, the motor rifle battalion of a mechanized brigade in the 4th Guards Tank Army. I fought for 2 years in the 4th Guards, from 1943 to 1945, and I covered around 3,800 kilometers with this unit. Such was my wartime voyage, and it was tough every step of the way. I participated in infantry assaults and rode into battle on tanks attacking the enemy positions. Intuition, experience of battle, and knowledge of enemy tactics saved my life many times, but I think that I mostly survived by pure luck. Luck was vital at the front, and I can't overemphasize its importance for any soldier. Evgeni Bessonov, 2003. Years of Childhood and Youth. I was born in Moscow on 20 July 1923, in number 77 Friedrich Engels Street, formerly known as Irinyinskaya. My father, Ivan Vasilievich Bessonov, moved to Moscow from a village in 1908 at the age of 15. Although he had almost no education, he managed to get a job in a small store and after a while became a prikazchik, salesman, and later senior salesman. In 1915, he married my mother, Olga Pavlovna, a native of Moscow. They had a daughter, Elena. We called her Lolya, in 1916, and that same year my father was drafted into the army. He served in the army until the February Revolution and retired in 1917. After the Great October Revolution, my father worked in trade before retiring in 1960. My mother studied at a school for tailors in Moscow, but didn't like to recall that period of her life. As she put it, It was pure drudgery. They had to get up at 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning, start the oven, cook tea for the foreman, wash dishes after their meal, and clean the rooms and the workshop. Such apprentices would only start their professional training several years later, as it was profitable for the master to have several minor servants, almost free of charge. After she completed her professional training and became a tailor, my mother got a job in a more prestigious tailor's shop at Kuznetsky Bridge and had a decent salary for that time, 37 to 40 rubles in 1913. After she married my father, she had 4 children and became a housewife. In early 1917, my parents were renting an apartment in the building where I was to be born. It was a typical Moscow yard, surrounded by a high fence. There were many small yards like this in the street, and they were named after the landlords: Krushinsky, Reshetkin, Maslov, Petrusinsky, and so on. There were 3 wooden buildings in our yard. 2 of them were available for a rather high rent, and the landlady with her family occupied the 3rd one. A carriage shed with stables was adjacent to the landlady's building. All the buildings were 1 story high, heated by stoves, without running water or plumbing, so we had to get water in the street from a water pump. The landlady had a fruit garden in the yard with apple and cherry trees, raspberry and gooseberry bushes. After the October Revolution, they took all 3 houses from the landlady, and father started to pay significantly less for the 2 12-square-meter rooms that we occupied. We had to share our kitchen with neighbors, who also had 2 rooms. A Russian stove heated our 2 rooms and 1 of the neighbors' rooms. In wintertime, the temperature would drop to 13 to 15 degrees Celsius by morning. Dinner, or food in general, was heated on kerosene heaters and Primus stoves. We also used these devices to boil water for tea, as the main stove and the oven were only stoked once a day. They only installed gas in the building after the Great Patriotic War, and the wood oven was only then replaced by a gas oven. Other conveniences, or rather inconveniences, remained the same. I should say that they only installed electric lights in our street in 1935 or 1936, and that the street had been illuminated by gas lamps until then. Every evening, a special worker would walk around the street and light the lamps and put them out in the morning. He carried a special ladder with him for this purpose, and the lampposts had a special crossbar to rest it on. Until the mid-1930s, our neighborhood was a haunt for thieves and hooligans, and we even had famous thieves living in our yard. Between 1936 and 1938, measures were taken. They all went to jail, and our neighborhood became quiet. Recalling our life before 1941, I think that our family had a modest life. We had a Singer sewing machine, and our mother made all our clothes for us with the help of this machine. Clothes were passed on from one sister to another, and I even received some things adapted from my sister's clothes. Our furniture was quite simple, for besides the sewing machine, we had a wall clock, a chest of drawers, an old wardrobe, 2 metallic beds, 2 chests that we children used as beds, chairs, and a bookshelf with some books. It was cramped. Sometimes I had a hard time finding somewhere to do my homework. For some time, my sister Lolia even had to sleep on the table, which was, fortunately, quite large. In every room in the place of honor, there were 3 icons with lampstands. Grandmother lit them up quite frequently. After Lolia and Galia entered Komsomol, the common name for VLKSM, the All-Union Lenin's Communistic Union of Youth, in 1933, my father took the icons down and hid them, leaving just 1 icon in the kitchen for our grandmother. On holidays, sometimes on Sundays, we would bake pierogi, pastries, jam patties, and sometimes a pirog with a jam or meat filling. Pirogi are small pies. A pirog here refers to a large one for the whole family. Translator's comment. For New Year, our father would buy a New Year tree, decorate it with toys, candles which we lit in the evening, and sweets if we had them. At Easter, my mother and grandmother baked 2 Easter cakes. Sometimes they went to the church to sanctify them. They would leave early and then stay there for a very long time. My father rarely invited guests. His friends with their wives, sometimes with children. Mother's friend, Aunt Shura, her former classmate, would come to visit her sometimes. Before leaving for school for the first shift, as there was a lack of schools, some of them had to organize teaching in 2 shifts, the first one in the morning and the second one in the evening. We had tea and bread with butter if we had it. We did not have any hot meal. After coming back from school, we had soup or shi, traditional Russian soup. The main ingredient is cabbage, translator's comment, for the first course. For the second course, we had potatoes, pasta, millet porridge or buckwheat porridge. Sometimes we had fried cutlets or fish. In the evenings, we had tea with bread. Very rarely, we had sausage. We had free breakfasts at school. On Sundays, we went with friends to watch films for children at a cinema, or to the Markov Club, or the Third International Cinema next to Baumanskaya metro station. The Markov Club was next to the school where I studied, on Bolshaya Pochtovaya Street. I went to the parades on Red Square on a regular basis, on 1 May and 7 November, together with our school or with the workers from the factory where our neighbor, Sergei Glazkov, a highly professional turner, worked. I liked going to parades. It was fun. People were dressed in festive clothes, sang songs, danced, orchestras played music everywhere, and children received gifts from the factories. Sweets, cookies, and soft drinks. Until the age of 13 or 14, I was a sickly and thin child. I would fall sick very often. I had scarlet fever, measles, pneumonia, and inflammation of my middle ear. I was shy. I was often lost when I had to answer in class. I could not always express my thoughts properly. First, I had trouble with mathematics. Then I got it sorted out. But I never learned to write properly. My writing has always been full of mistakes. In order to improve my health, I started to do sports. Athletics, cross-country skiing, soccer, and volleyball. We had high jump and long jump competitions. For 2 years, I was in the wrestling section at Lokomotiv Stadium, at the same place where I lifted weights in order to strengthen my muscles. In the school, we boys jumped over the vaulting horse and did some exercises on the horizontal bar. Sports did me good, for I became stronger physically, and illness left me alone. In the 10th grade, I was the school's best high jumper, together with my classmates Fakin and Zolotukhin. I took part in the district-level ski race, but did not achieve any outstanding success. The same with wrestling. When I was called up to the army in September 1941, I was 180 centimeters high and weighed 70 kilograms, which was a normal combination for an 18-year-old boy. Sports helped me to take the physical stress in army life and at the front. Later, in the army, I discovered a talent for shooting small arms, especially pistols. I was not too brave, and so I got into fights very rarely. Not only because I did not know how to fight, but also because of my character. I felt bad hitting someone in the face, especially a friend. I was never angry with anyone, unlike some other boys. A couple of times I was hit, and just could not bring myself to hit back. I think I was the last one in our class to join come some all. That was as late as 1939. I was a pioneer in junior classes, so I had my red tie before I entered. The Young Pioneers was a youth organization for 10 to 15-year-olds, highly ideological, in character with aims of educating children about the Soviet state, the history of the Communist Party, etc. Translator's comment. When our 341st school joined the trade school in December 1940, we were transferred to the 350th school on Bolshaya Pochtovaya Street. The Komsomol organization elected me the chairman of voluntary Asavyahim Society, renamed DASAF after the war. This was the Society for the Promotion of Aviation and Defense Against Chemicals. It was an educational organization in the USSR in the 1930s, providing a basic military education along with training in defense against chemicals. Translator's comment. I would not say that this organization did a lot of activities in the school, but there were sometimes shooting competitions, which were especially important. We arranged hiking trips in gas masks. Sometimes even classes and other activities were done in gas masks. My best friends in the street at that time were Vladimir Dalmatov, Pyotr Hromyshev, Lev Kalihalov, and Evgeny Bogolyubsky. Later, my best friends in my class were Alexander Fokin and Andrei Atriganyev. We all lived close to our school. We had common views and areas of interest. We were all tall and athletic guys and attained similar results in our studies. Unfortunately, in the last quarter of the 1941 school year, we stopped all sports activities. We had to prepare for graduation exams. After a long discussion, several guys from my class, including me, decided to apply for the Sevastopol Naval Academy. But I did not pass the medical commission. They said I had color blindness, rather insignificant though. Nevertheless, the commission found me unfit for service in the Navy and Air Force. I also tried to enter a pilot club. We schoolmates did not think of war, believing that war would take place on the enemy's territory, and we were lighthearted then. I passed all my graduation exams with distinction, except for Russian literature composition. The graduation party took place on 17 June, and we received our maturity certificates. The war started 5 days later. The war begins. I first heard that the war had broken out while I was in the city, where I had gone with Vladimir Grivnin, my classmate. We had plans to go to a retro film theater, which was at Nikitsky Gate. We young boys took the news quite calmly. We thought that the Nazi invaders were about to be thrown back from the country's borders. But exactly the opposite happened. This conflict, the harshest of all wars, would last 1,418 days for us, or 3 years, 10 months, and 17 days. On 25 or 26 June 1941, I, along with other Komsomol members, was invited to the Baumansky District Committee of Komsomol. There they suggested that we go to the Bryansk region to build fortifications. On the evening of the same day, we were loaded onto a train with some personal belongings and food. We traveled westwards to build fortifications. We started to work at Kirov City in the Bryansk region. We worked 12 hours a day, and as we were not used to physical labor, we were really exhausted. We fell asleep as soon as our heads touched our beds of hay or straw, which were made mostly in barns. We dug anti-tank ditches, dug around the riverbanks, dug trenches, and set barbed wire obstacles. In some cases, we had to repair the railways destroyed during air raids and clear them from the debris of destroyed goods trains. However, Our main job was to dig anti-tank ditches. The food was poor. It was not enough for us, and the village population was not very kind to us. Our foreman, who arrived with us from Moscow, had to talk to the locals, mostly to leaders of the kolkhoz, collective farm or village, if they had not been drafted into the army, and persuade them to give us some food, at least potatoes. Such talks helped, but quite rarely. The German Air Force bombed us several times. Scared, we ran in all directions like rabbits. We were young and healthy and could run fast. We did not suffer any losses, especially as the bombs exploded far away from us. But as we had not seen fire, we were quaking in our boots. We worked there for 45 days, until 8 August 1941, and then were urgently loaded on a train, and in the morning of 9 August, we were back in Moscow, at Kiev Station. College students were drafted in the army on the spot and were sent to different units. When we, 5 to 7 young men, walked into a metro train, passengers started to pay attention to us. We were dirty and ragged, in patched-up shirts and trousers, our hair grown long and dirty and tangled. However, women came up to us and started to ask us who we were, where we were from. When they learned that we were from the labor front, they, just like all mothers, started to ask us about their children. But we had not known or seen anyone that they were asking about. When I came home, there was already an official paper that said that I had been drafted into the Red Army and had to show up at the assembly point in school in Takhmakov Lane by 11 August. That was the assembly point for the Baumansky District Military Commissariat of Moscow. Some neighbors in the street and classmates also received similar call-up notes. During the night of 12 August, we were loaded onto a train, taking our places in freight wagons for 40 men or 8 horses, and we rolled eastwards. On the way, individual cars were taken away as the men were sent to different military academies. Alexander Fokin left our company this way. In the vicinity of Chelyabinsk, we were quartered in tents at the Chebarkulsky military camp, where army units of the Urals military district stayed during the summer. Before the cold weather set in, we lived in that camp, mostly doing drill. We still had civilian clothes. With the arrival of cold weather, we were transferred to the summer film theater of the Chelyabinsk Park of Culture. Moscow also had similar summer film theaters before the war. The autumn in the Urals was cold. We were freezing in the film theater. Some were falling sick, and the shoes of some men fell apart. Plus, the food was very bad, and some men turned to theft. After that, some top brass decided to get rid of this large, unmanageable, and motley crew. We were at least 500, the majority of whom went into the city in the morning searching for food. They started to send the men out to different places of service. My friends Turanov, Tvarogov, and Silvanovich left. I met them only after the war in Moscow. They all went through the war and survived, although Silvanovich was crippled after being wounded. In October, a strange sergeant major picked us, some 20 men, and together with him we went to a kolkhoz to harvest potatoes, which the locals had not managed to harvest before the first frosts. They put us in an unheated room. We were freezing at night, but we were getting so tired during the day that we did not notice the cold. That was in the Urals region, and it was already mid or late October. The villagers did not help us at all, did not give us either food or firewood. We did not even have a pot to boil potatoes in. We were constantly hungry. Besides that, many of us, including me, caught cold. Our superior also did not take proper care of us. It was good that they made a decision to move us back to Chelyabinsk. I can, to some extent, understand the words of one woman from a village where we had been digging anti-tank trenches, who refused to give us food, saying, "What am I going to feed the Germans with when they come?" But that was in Bryansk region, not in the Urals, which was far away from the Germans. Never again in my life did I meet such people. They really deserve their name, Chaldons, a name for Russians living in Siberia. However, normally the name does not have any negative connotation. Translator's comment. We only encountered such attitudes in the western Ukraine, but those were Bandera's areas. Bandera was a famous Ukrainian anti-Soviet resistance leader, translator's comment, which only became part of USSR in 1940. We never returned to the summer film theater in Chelyabinsk. We removed from one barracks to another, but the good thing was that they were at least warm. They fed us really badly. Boiled root beets in hot water, and that was it. Instead of dishes, we had a clean small wash tub. It is hard to explain such poverty. It was only the fourth month of the war. We saw plenty of soldiers drafted from the reserve. They were gloomy, untidy, a set of doomed 40-year-old men who looked much older. I never met such backward men at the front. It was amazing that they were Siberian. In early November 1941, some 400 of us were loaded onto a train in Chelyabinsk. We were all sent to Kamishlov Military Infantry Academy. We suffered a lot from hunger on the way to Kamishlov. As usual, they appointed a crook as the senior man of our team. He received the food for the whole group, gave out a ration for one day, and disappeared with the rest of the food. We never saw him again. Stealing was widespread in the early days of the war, while thieves were hard to catch. Hungry boys literally turned over food kiosks at railway stations, taking everything they could find. After several similar attacks, they started to make stops only in open fields and not at railway stations or villages. I received some food from the guys that I knew, mostly bread. They unloaded us in the town of Kamishlov in the Sverdlovsk region, some 180 kilometers to the east of Sverdlovsk, now Yekaterinburg. The ones that arrived on that train were distributed among four companies, the 13th, 14th, 15th, and 16th, which formed the 4th Battalion. I ended up in the 15th Company. Those who stubbornly and consistently refused to study, as well as some former criminals, were sent into army units that were in process of formation for the front in the Urals region. We were sworn in at the academy on 16 November 1941 and were all officially accepted as cadets. First, we received boots with puttees instead of jackboots. We had a hard time with them. You try to wrap it around your leg, and all of a sudden it slips out of your hand, and you have to start all over again. During that period, almost all soldiers of the Red Army had boots with puttees, especially the infantry. They issued winter uniforms to us in the academy. That was when puttees were replaced by jackboots. Cotton footcloths, woolen tunics, and padded trousers, a padded jacket to be worn under the greatcoat, and mittens. We did not have winter hats, though, and we had to walk around in garrison caps. Some put a towel under a garrison cap when the temperatures dropped to minus 20 to 25 degrees Celsius. That winter, frosts in the Urals region were sharp. We saw sparrows freezing to death in mid-flight. I am not making this up. We received winter hats as late as January 1942. We lived on the first floor of a huge two-story barrack. We slept on two-level metallic beds. We ourselves stuffed mattresses and pillows with hay in the administration platoon of the academy. We were issued 2 sheets and a cotton blanket. There were 2 large Orel-style wood stoves in the opposite corners of the barrack. Every floor housed 2 companies of 120 men each. Companies were separated by a wide corridor, where we would all fall in for a morning inspection, form number 20, the code for a lice check, and an evening inspection. In the ends of the barrack building, there were a storage room, officer's room, a rifle park, or more accurately, a rifle pyramid, bathroom and toilets. Classes lasted from 10 to 12 hours, including individual study time. The reveille was at 6 o'clock or 6:30. I do not remember exactly. Taps were at 2300. We would get very tired during the day, as we only had classes outdoors, so we were always hungry and sleepy. They fed us quite well. They gave us some 750 grams of bread a day, sugar at breakfast and dinner for our tea. Breakfast, as a rule, included porridge, a piece of butter, 20 grams, tea and bread. For lunch, we had soup or shi based on meat bouillon, mashed potatoes or porridge with meat for the second course, stewed fruit and bread. Dinner was quite poor. Beetroot salad or a piece of boiled fish, sometimes herring, with potatoes, tea, bread and sugar. Cadets had even better food than commanders. In 1941 and 1942, officers in the Red Army were still officially referred to as commanders, translators comment, in their own canteen. However, we were using a lot of energy and spending all the daytime in the frost outside, so our young bodies required more food and sleep. The sleeping time was insufficient for us, although we had a rest time after lunch. Some cadets could not take such physical stress and grew noticeably weaker and thinner. The others, not used to such strong frosts, had their feet frostbitten. Our company commander was Senior Lieutenant Suleymanov, a Kazakh, physically strong and an excellent training officer. The company had 4 platoons, 30 cadets in each platoon. The academy had a total of 20 companies, 5 battalions. Lieutenant Khrapovitsky was leader of my platoon, the first, and Lieutenant Ilyin led the 2nd platoon. I forget the names of the other 2 platoon leaders. The majority of cadets in the 1st and the 2nd platoons were Muscovites, while the 3rd and the 4th platoons mostly had local men from the Urals and adjacent areas. The head of the academy was the Kambrik, pre-war and early war Red Army rank that corresponds to Major General, translators comment. He had 1 diamond on his collar tab, though the army had already introduced general ranks. We saw him quite rarely, mostly during parades, which we only had 2 or 3 times during our stay in the academy. They said that he was just recently released from jail. He had been arrested as a former officer of the Tsar's army, as had happened with Rokossovsky, Marshal of Soviet Union, and General Garbatov. In mid-December 1941, our company was sent to a winter camp outside the city, where we lived in dugouts and slept on 2-level plank beds. There was no running water there. We had to wash ourselves with snow after the physical exercises, which we had to do outside in any frost, and by morning, temperatures dropped to as low as minus 30 to 35 degrees Celsius. We skied 18 kilometers to banya 3 times a month. A banya is a traditional Russian steam bath, translators note. We also studied drill and ceremonies. Ceremonial step, turning to left, right, around, and saluting. At that time, they called it greeting each other and the commanders. We studied weapons, service, and field manuals. We also studied tactics. We rehearsed attacks on the enemy, as well as platoon and company action in defense. Sometimes we had range practice. After a month or a month and a half, we returned to barracks in the city. We were forbidden to leave the military area and go to town, but there was nothing to do there anyway. We had a post office, a store with all kinds of small things that a soldier might need, such as threads and needles. There was also a club with a cinema and a library. On Sundays, we cadets had a day off as well. I went to the library and read newspapers there, usually Pravda. I borrowed fiction, took it to the barracks, and managed to find time to read it there. We marched in formation to see movies. Normally, that was during the morning before lunch. I only remember one film, The Destruction of German Forces at Moscow. During the other films, I would fall asleep, just like so many other cadets, even though the heating of the hall was very poor. When we were on duty in the company, a cadet on duty and three orderlies, we ran to the station cafe at the time of arrival of a train from Moscow to get some wheat porridge. It was not millet, but wheat porridge. There was nothing else in the cafe. We normally had it poured into the fire bucket. Several pieces of bread were also given with the porridge. We would finish the bucket of porridge during the night, and if we had porridge left, we woke up a couple of our friends. By morning, the bucket was to be cleaned and hung on the firefighting stand again. There were different cadets in the academy. Honest, responsive, helping each other, sharing food parcels with close friends according to the cadet's rule of thumb. Others were dishonest and did not respect even the elementary requirements of discipline. The cadets themselves dealt with thieves. In any case, the older cadets did not abuse the younger ones, or if they did, we did not know anything about it. It was easy for me to overcome the difficulties of military service, the same with the Frosts. I was the third tallest cadet in the company. The tallest was Anatoly Pavlovich Zlobin, an outstanding writer after the war. He died in 2000. We were drafted from Moscow together. He was a mortar battery commander at the front. I had good relations with all the men in the company. While in the platoon, we were all good friends. We were all Muscovites from the same neighborhood and graduated from neighboring schools. We even had common acquaintances. We had nothing to fight about. Physically, I was no worse than the other cadets in the platoon and the company. I was not outstanding, but I stood up for myself. I did not flatter anyone and didn't tell tales. The company commander was somehow distant from us. We did not see him every day. In the evenings, we had classes with assistant platoon leaders. As a rule, these were older cadets, not the former schoolboys, but cadets that had entered the academy earlier than ourselves. Some men had a hard time with the studies, and two cadets could not take it. One local man, Lisitsin, shot himself in a dugout during his company guard duty. The second guy, Vishnevsky, a native of Moscow, escaped. They looked for him for a long time, but never found him. Both incidents were emergency cases for the company. Later, there was a rumor that a letter came from Vishnevsky, in which he wrote that he was at the front and asked not to be considered a deserter. However, the letter was not officially read to us, probably so that other cadets would not follow his example. We had to learn in 6 months what we would have studied for 2 years in the pre-war military academy. The front needed officers for platoon company level, as these were being killed the fastest at the front. We studied field manuals and had to learn in practice, as they say, in the Army Infantry Field Manual of 1936, from the actions of individual soldiers to the responsibilities of a company commander in defense and attack. This manual was abolished in 1942 and replaced by a revised manual which was based on the experience gained in the first year of war. We were also supposed to know the Army Manual, Internal Service Manual, guard duty manual, and drill manual by heart. Besides that, we studied technical manuals. We were supposed to know the weapons, assembling and disassembling weapons, employment, failures, and repair, principles of its work. We studied the Morsin rifle model 1892-1930, the Simonov automatic rifle, the Dekhtyaryov light machine gun, RPD or DP, and the Maxim heavy machine gun. The difficulty with that was in assembling and disassembling its bolt, or rather lock, which was intricate. This machine gun, just like the Morsin rifle, dated back to the First World War and the Russian Civil War, and was used until the end of the Great Patriotic War. Besides those weapons, we studied mortars. The 37mm company mortar, later withdrawn from service. The 50mm and the 82mm mortars, their technical data and employment, firing conditions, and preparation for firing. I should say that the level of training was poor, as the teachers did not understand the subject themselves. In general, during the war, our mortar crews were really bad shooters. Of course, artillery units, mortar battalions, and even regiments were very well trained, but the infantry mortars were not that successful. Indeed, they almost killed me once. German mortar teams were very good and well trained, while their artillery was just average. Along with all the other things, we were also trained in the language of command. In comparison with other subjects, I achieved outstanding success in this field, and also had political classes. Political classes were confined to lectures given by a teacher. Exhausted cadets could hardly take them, and some fell asleep. I can remember it myself. I was always dozing off at those lectures, and nothing remains in my memory from them. But in general, most of the time in the academy was spent on military subjects. Training was intensive, and we became quite exhausted. We never completed the course of preparation of fire data for the 82mm mortar, and we had to learn this in our units at the front. But I stayed in infantry, and besides me, at least 30 men were not sent to mortar units. We never fired live ammo from those mortars, which was wise given that apparently our platoon leaders and company commander themselves did not really know how to operate them. Except for the company commander, they were all graduates of the same Kamishlov Infantry Academy and had not had mortar or artillery courses during their studies, as they would have had in artillery academies. They studied the theory of shooting a mortar together with us and could not give us any decent knowledge, while we cadets did not take that mortar course seriously. Our course was over, and in early May 1942, the cadets received their military ranks. Some became lieutenants and some junior lieutenants. To my great dismay, I was among the latter. I was upset, but gradually I calmed down. What was the difference? We all had to go to the front as platoon leaders anyway. 480 officers, 4 companies, graduated. The graduation was passed unnoticed, just like another day. It was wartime. The barracks were empty. New cadets had yet to arrive. We said goodbye to everyone. Too many of them for good. I was not even 19 years old, and we now had to lead other people, soldiers, who were older than us. The burden of responsibility that the war put on our young shoulders was especially heavy. We, young men, almost boys, had to lead at least 100 mature and experienced men. We were responsible for their lives, for orders. We had to solve moral problems. But we, the young ones, did not bend and did not break. That's the way it was. Some commanders, we were no longer cadets. Some 25 to 30 men, including me, stayed in the academy. They told us that we were supposed to undergo training as tank hunter platoon leaders in the anti-tank rifle platoon. No one really knew what this might involve. Afterwards, we received an explanation in the form of a manual. It stated that in every rifle battalion, first a platoon and then an anti-tank rifle company were to be formed to engage the enemy's tanks. The Academy received two anti-tank rifles, the first one a Dektyaryov model and the second a Simonov, the semi-automatic one, as well as anti-tank grenades. We rarely fired the rifles, as we had to spare the ammo, and threw dummy grenades instead of live ones. Then, in early July 1942, we were sent to an army unit. We did not go straight to the front, but ended up in the 365th Reserve Rifle Regiment of the 46th Reserve Rifle Brigade at Sorok Station in the Mariskaya region. They trained replacements for the units at the front in that regiment. Red Army soldiers did basic military training, mostly shooting and tactics, the usual actions of an individual soldier in squad and platoon. Lieutenant Zhukov, a man from our academy and a Muscovite, and I were sent to a sniper company. A 40-year-old, Junior Lieutenant Chudakov, who was called up from reserve, was the company commander. I became platoon leader. I had 30 men as my subordinates. They were all of different ages and nationalities, and many of them had already lived a long life. At first, I was a bit uncomfortable giving orders to older men, and I felt frustrated, but later it all seemed normal. The platoon leader's wage was 600 rubles a month. 50 rubles were deducted as a military tax, and we got 550 rubles in cash. But we did not have anything to spend the money on, as there were no shops in the regiment. Outside the regiment, there was a rationing system, and market prices were very high. A loaf of bread was 200 to 250 rubles. Half a liter of vodka or moonshine was 250 to 300 rubles. That was all we could get for our wage. Besides shooting and studying weapons in the sniper company, we taught the men to dig in with a small entrenching tool, camouflage in terrain, advance in short rushes, throw grenades, mostly RGD-33s, and to charge with the bayonet. They sent younger men who were enthusiastic about marksmanship to the sniper company, and they tried to reach my level of skill, but there were very few men in the regiment who could shoot better than me. Although we did not have real combat experience, we taught our subordinates to do the things that we knew and could do after graduation from the military academy. The training period for snipers was extended in comparison with the training period of a private from an infantry company. After 2 or 3 months of training, or sometimes even less, men were sent as replacements to the combat units. But the regiment's officers, or more correctly, commanders, were rarely sent to the front. For example, I spent at least 1 year in the regiment. During the summer and autumn of 1942, I was twice sent as an escorting officer for marching companies to the combat units, first to Mozhaisk area, and the second time to Voronezh area. The task of the escorting officer was to deliver the company without losses in personnel. There were cases of escapes. Sometimes the political officer of the company accompanied the company commander. Marching companies were normally brought to the divisional or regimental HQ, where men were distributed among units. Officers also started to leave for the front from the 365th Reserve Regiment. Officers that came to the regiment were from hospitals, where they had been recovering after wounds, sometimes serious ones. It was time for me to leave the regiment. I had been stuck in that regiment for a long time, but I obtained experience of leading men and received advanced knowledge of military science, and I also became an excellent shooter. I did not have any good friends left in the regiment. Many of them had left already, and I was happy to leave the reserve regiment. In late May 1943, I was sent to the personnel section of the Moscow Military District. They sent me and other officers to a battalion of the officer reserve in Kuchino, in the vicinity of Moscow, where the battalion was stationed. I did not stay there for long, just around a month. We did almost nothing there and tried to get sent to the front as quickly as possible. In late July 1943, we, around 100 officers, were sent to the Bryansk front. We started our journey from Moscow by train, then we hitchhiked, and then even had to walk. That was the time of the Kursk battle, one of the largest battles of the war. Our counteroffensive started successfully, but because of bloody fighting in defense and then in attack, units suffered heavy losses both in men and officers. That is why the units of the Bryansk front desperately needed replacements. Baptism of Fire. The Orel Offensive. We arrived at the HQ of the Bryansk front on 2 or 3 August 1943 and were distributed among different armies of the front. Along with several other officers, I was sent to the 4th Tank Army, which launched its attack on 26 July and was engaged in fighting, overcoming enemy resistance and advancing towards Orel. On around 8 or 9 August, we arrived at the HQ of the 4th Army, which were located in a ravine with all the necessary camouflage against the enemy's air force. During that period, the army commander was Lieutenant General V.M. Badanov. After a brief discussion with the chief of the army's personnel section, I was sent, along with several other officers, to the 6th Guards Mechanized Corps under the command of Major General A.I. Akimov. From the personnel section of the corps staff, we were sent to different brigades. By that time, I was only accompanied by 5 to 7 officers from the 100 that departed from Moscow. Some were sent to the 16th Guards Mechanized Brigade, the others to the 17th Guards, while I was the only officer who was sent to the 49th Mechanized Brigade. It had not yet been awarded with the Guards title. The brigade was commanded by Lieutenant Colonel Pyotr Nikitich Turkin. After some hesitation, on 13 or 14 August, the head of the personnel section of the brigade decided to send me to the 1st Motor Rifle Battalion as a replacement. The commander of the battalion at that time was Senior Lieutenant Terenty Grigorievich Kozienko. He became captain as late as October 1943. They sent a runner from the battalion so that I did not have to wander around the ravines looking for the battalion HQ. With the runner, I reported my arrival for further service to the battalion chief of staff, Captain S.P. Mazurov. The 1st Battalion had just disengaged the enemy, and the men were putting themselves in order. This brief pause in the fighting was a great help for me. I was able to get to know the personnel quickly outside active operations during a half-day break. I was appointed the platoon leader of the 2nd platoon in the 1st company, which was under the command of Junior Lieutenant Pyotr Ivanovich Titov. I fought the whole war as the 2nd platoon leader, and only in September to October of 1945 was I officially appointed the commander of the 1st company. Pyotr Sergeyevich Shakula was the leader of the 1st platoon, while the leader of the 3rd platoon was Lieutenant Gavrilov. I forget his first name. The machine gun platoon leader was not there. He was in hospital after receiving a serious wound. The company's sergeant major was Vasily Blakhin, former seaman of the Pacific Navy. The company had medic Safronov, company clerk Barakovsky, as well as a sniper, a big Kazakh called Jambul. The deputy battalion commander for political affairs, or Zampalit, was Abram Yefimovich Gerstein, and the deputy battalion commander, personnel section, was Senior Lieutenant Maxim Tarasovich Burkov, who was killed on 16 January 1945. The 2nd Motor Rifle Company was under Lieutenant Afanasy Nikitovich Gulik, while the 3rd was under Lieutenant Yuri Alexeyevich Grigoryev, who became the battalion's chief of staff in May 1944. Sergeant Major Blokhin introduced me to the assistant platoon leader, Senior Sergeant Sabayev, and the orderly in the company. On the evening of the same day, we moved forward to our attack position in order to assault the Germans in the morning. During the night, we three officers of the company were summoned by Company Commander Titov, who gave us our combat objectives for the attack. I did not recognize the platoon leaders in the darkness. They did not recognize me either. At dawn, the company formed a line, and together with two other companies of the battalion, walked with a rapid step towards the hill, having no idea if the enemy was defending it. That was my baptism of fire. This was no longer training. It was war, and the enemy was in front of us. The enemy first opened up with machine gun fire from the hill, and then launched a concentrated mortar barrage on us. Just as I had in training, I ordered the soldiers, "Forward run," and ran forward myself, just as I had in training. All of a sudden, my soldiers were no longer in front of me. I heard voices from the side, from a ravine, where the soldiers from the company and from my platoon had already taken cover. They started to dig in. I did not even have an entrenching tool, let alone weapons, neither a pistol nor a submachine gun. I only received weapons a couple of days later. To the right of me, there was a soldier who had already dug his skirmisher's trench, so I asked for an entrenching tool from him. I dug in and made a breastwork. I gave the entrenching tool back to the red-headed man and asked who he was. He answered that he was platoon leader from the 1st Company, Lieutenant Pyotr Shakula. I had only seen him once in the night and did not recognize him in daylight. This is how Pyotr Shakula became my best friend for the whole war. Our friendship lasted until his very death in 1988. After darkness fell, we left the ravine and dug in at an open spot right in front of the hill, trying our best to camouflage our narrow foxholes from the enemy's air force and from observation. During the night, we received an order to repeat the assault on the enemy forces defending the hill. A night assault is a special type of combat. It is complicated and requires the close cooperation of all battalion units, even between the individual soldiers of the company. It also requires bravery and fearlessness. The assault began well until we reached a barbed wire entanglement and the company had to lie down in front of it. How could we overcome the obstacle? We did not have wire cutters. It might well be that several soldiers could sneak under the entanglement together with me. But what about the rest? Would they follow? It was impossible to see in the darkness. Would they help me, or would I help them? That's the main thing in night combat. I did not know what to do, and I sneaked out to look for Shakula and Gavrilov, the two other platoon leaders.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.